is Your Life. America's most talked about program is brought to you by Hazel Bishop, America's largest selling lipstick because it's America's longest lasting lipstick. And now here he is, your host on This Is Your Life, Ralph Edwards.
That's the Hazel Bishop High Sign. That's what that is, ladies and gentlemen. You get that? And it means long-lasting lipstick and long-lasting enjoyment on This Is Your Life. See what I mean? New salute we do here now, all this. Well, tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we bring you what we believe to be perhaps the most dramatic story in our series. Our principal subject is an ex-Army sergeant. And he's in a soundproof dressing room backstage right now waiting. He thinks to make an appeal on a subject that's very close to him. We'll find out about that in a moment. Now, he does not know that this is your life, nor that his is the life we're to relive here in the next half hour. You may bring him out of the dressing room. It'll take him a second to get here. When he does get here, a nice big hand, ladies and gentlemen. Friends, I want you to meet a gentleman whom I'm sure you'll all take into your hearts. Mr. Roy Keezer, now residing in El Segundo, California. Mr. Keezer, how do you do, sir? Good to see you, sir. Well, sir, I'm Ralph Edwards, Mr. Keezer. I've never had the pleasure of meeting you before.
Very glad to meet you, sir.
Certainly nice to meet you. I haven't had a chance to tell our viewers very much about you, so let's just review some of the facts, shall we now? Your first name is Roy.
Roy, yes, sir.
All right. May I ask, how old are you, Roy?
46.
Uh-huh. What do you do there in El Segundo?
I'm working in the Lumen Paper Milling Company now at the present time.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. A job that pays you how much? Do you mind saying?
Well, $1.68 an hour for night work.
Take home would be about 80
well, with
or
six,
85 a week. Would.
Well, with six children right now, it's 89.37.
You have six children?
Yes, sir.
I see. Where are they, Roy?
They're in the Philippine Islands.
Oh, would this be a picture of them there?
Yes, sir.
Huh?
Yes, sir.
You surprised that I have that picture?
I am.
Well, it's a mighty fine looking, I was going to say little family, but there are quite a few there.
A big family.
Yes, Roy, I want to tell you something. We've played a little trick on you, and I'm sure you'll find it a happy one. I want you to look at the cover of this book. Yes, Roy Keezer. Born in Jackson Hill, Indiana, This Is Your Life. Now, do you know the show, This Is Your Life?
I've never seen it on television.
Well, you have a big surprise in store for you tonight, then, sir. We're happy to get someone who hasn't seen the show. I think you're one of the first in a long time.
I am.
You have a great, great thrill in store for you. Take your place here. This is our chair of honor. I want you to sit right over here, please. A place I'm sure we'll all agree, as your life unfolds, you fully deserve. Now, yours is the story of a man whom fate has seldom treated with kindness. Yet your heart holds neither bitterness nor resentment. Jackson Hill, an Indiana mining town, on August 26, 1907. A second son is born to William Franklin and Gertrude Maud Keezer. You, Roy. Soon, two more sons are added to the Keezer family. What are your brothers' names, Roy?
George, Walter, and Merville.
George, Walter, and Merville. Your father, a coal miner, works hard and provides well. To his four sons, as to all little boys, each day is full of promise and excitement. Now, who could have foreseen the tragedy that was to settle on the Keezer home in 1913 when you were just 6 years old, Roy?
That was the year that the boy's father was killed in a mine accident in Jackson Hill Mine Number 2.
A voice out of your early childhood. Do you recognize it, Roy?
I do.
You do, eh?
My mother.
It belongs to your mother, whom you have not seen more than once or twice in the past 40 years. And I'm sure she'll tell us why. Here she is, your mother, now Mrs. Bart Milholland from Brownwood, Texas. Right here. Mrs. Milholland, what happened after the death of your husband? Do you want to tell us?
Well, I took the boys back to St. Charles, Kentucky, where I formerly lived.
Yes. You had friends there and relatives, didn't you?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Well, then where did you go?
Moved to a ranch in Texas.
Yes, ma'am. Then what happened, Mrs. Milholland?
Well, it was hard to know what to do.
Yes.
Left with four little boys, and it was hard for a woman to make money to support and take care of four little boys.
Yes,
so
ma'am.
I had to give them up.
Yes. Well, we understand. You placed them in a private orphanage in Fort Worth, Texas.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. That must have been a difficult decision.
It was the hardest decision any mother ever had to make.
I'm sure it must have been. Why don't you sit right here? Roy, you come over here, pal. That's it. And you sit right here for a second. We're all wondering, of course, what happened to the four Keyser brothers. Just sit down there, Ms. Milholland, right there. That's all right. And the best way to find out, I guess, what happened to them is to ask them themselves. So here they are, Roy, your brothers. George, Walter, and Merville. Let's get them all out here now. Man alive. George, you get over there. You're the oldest, so you get there. What happened to you after you were placed in the orphanage, George?
I was adopted by Mr. and Mrs. Bart Milholland in Brownwood, Texas.
Uh-huh. What do you do now, George?
I drive a truck for Benny Keith Produce Company in Abilene.
Wonderful. Now, what about you, Walter?
I was adopted to Mr. and Mrs. Martin, George F. Martin, Abilene, Texas.
What do you do now, sir?
I sell mechanical tools in Fort Worth.
Wonderful. My, they're handsome sons here. Mother, what's that?
Wonderful,
you bet. And you, Merville, you're the baby of the family. What about you?
Yes, Ralph, I am. I'm the smallest and the baby of the family.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a chiropractic physician now, and I'm now residing in Albuquerque, New Mexico.
Yes, sir. Well, that brings us to you, Roy. Were you adopted, too?
No, I never was adopted.
Mm-hmm. You went sort of to work on a farm, didn't you? That
yes,
sort of
I
thing,
know.
Where at the age of seven, you learned to walk behind a one-horse plow and corn planter, doing a man's job. Your footsteps, Roy Keyser, will take us halfway around the world in peace and in war to return to America with the prayerful determination in your heart that your children shall have a better chance in life than fate decreed for you. This is your life, Roy Keyser. And you know, all the folks in our studio audience think you're the only one who's supposed to be up here tonight. Well, I've got news for them. Now, let's see. Where is she? Oh, yeah, there she is. There she is, right out there, isn't it? Miss Doris Carr, who has a television show of her own here on the West Coast. Yes, Doris. Come on. Come on up on our Hazel Bishop stage, won't you? Doris Carr, ladies and gentlemen.
Come over here, Doris. I want to talk to you.
Bob, you sure pulled a fast one on me.
Oh, Fred, I'm the culprit. See, I wanted to talk to a girl who uses Hazel Bishop lipstick, and I didn't want her to know anything about it beforehand. And when I found out you were a Hazel Bishop girl, I just couldn't resist the temptation.
Well, Bob, I have to be very angry with you, but for Hazel Bishop lipstick, anything.
Wonderful.
Yes. I have mine right here.
Hey, that's really wonderful. Now, would you mind telling us how you started using Hazel Bishop lipstick?
Well, Bob, at first I was intrigued because it didn't smear off.
Mm-hmm.
But what I love most about Hazel Bishop lipstick is that it stays on so much longer. You see, between running a household, taking care of my children, and doing my television shows, well, I just don't have time to keep putting lipstick on all day. But with Hazel Bishop, I put it on in the morning, and it stays set for the rest of the day.
Doris Carr, thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Bob.
Come back and see us again sometime?
I shall. Thank you.
Okay.
Bye.
Say, ladies, why don't you stop wearing an ordinary lipstick? Change to Hazel Bishop. It's America's largest selling lipstick because it's America's longest lasting lipstick.
Are you ready to pick up where we left off? Hmm?
I am.
The pattern of your childhood and your early teens is loneliness and longing for your mother and your brothers. This is your life, Roy Keyser, before you achieve manhood. The years roll by, years spent in various orphanages and working on various farms in Illinois. School is a luxury you enjoy only now and then. The future holds little promise for you. In 1925, you reached the age of 18. So what did you do, Roy?
I enlisted in the Army.
Right. You're sent to Fort McKinley near Manila, where you're a mule skinner.
That's right.
How many hitches did you serve in the Army, Roy?
Well, four.
Four. Let's see. 12 years in all, ending up as a sergeant. May 12th, 1935.
Well,
that's an important date in your life, isn't it, Roy?
I got out, really, in 1938.
Yeah, but I'm thinking about this day. That's the day you were married.
Oh, yes.
To a lovely girl, Aida Aragon.
That's right.
You take a house in Cavite City, and it's the first place you really can call home since you were 5 years old. The next 6 years are happy ones, aren't they, Roy?
Yes, they are.
In 1936, your first son, William Roy, is born. A year later, you have a daughter, Irene. And in 1941, there's another little girl, Gertrude. You're looking forward to the day when you can bring your little family to your native land, to America. And then, Pearl Harbor, December 7th, 1941.
Roy was out of the Army then and working as foreman for Contractor Specific Naval Air Bases. But his greatest service to his country was yet to come.
Have you any idea who that is, Roy?
No, I don't.
You haven't seen this man or heard from him in nearly 12 years, not since you and a handful of other civilian workers volunteered for the final suicidal demolition job at the Cavite Naval Base before the Japanese came in. And here he is, Jim Neal, right here.
Pretty good.
Good to see you.
Well, I'll say.
You were in charge of that final demolition crew at Cavite in 1941, weren't you, Jim?
Yes, I was. It was late in December, and
Have the Japanese come in yet?
The Japanese had come in. There was landings on the island at that time.
Well, what was your assignment, actually, Jim?
My assignment was to get rid of all the stuff on Sunset Beach.
Yes, sir?
There were several stacks of mines and aerial torpedoes, about 100 of them, and 12 to 15 tons of ammunition there. It had been saturated with gasoline in order to set it afire. But they changed that order because it was too dangerous. It had too many lives endangered in the near villages.
Sure. So what did you fellas do?
We had to go in there by hand and take it out of there piece by piece and roll it into the ocean. And it was pretty hard to do. It was liable to go off at any time, some of it.
How long
had
did it take?
Had to be handled pretty carefully. It took us about 7 days and nights to finish the job.
Under almost constant bombing and strafing by enemy planes. Thank you very much, Jim Neal. Thank you for your part in that heroic action and in the life of Roy Keenser. What did you do when the Japanese invaded the Philippines, Roy?
Well, I was with the contractors.
And you went underground, didn't you?
Well, after the fall of Bataan and Pregador, yes. After the Japanese occupied Manila, I went underground.
Joined the guerrillas.
Yes.
With the enemy ever at your heels, you hid from house to house, from village to village. Many times your life was saved by the friendly, heroic Filipinos.
That's right.
Yes, but we of the Philippines owe more than our lives to Roy Keenser and his fellow Americans.
I don't think you know that voice, do you, Roy?
I don't.
This lady was actually your commanding officer because General Douglas MacArthur appointed her a general of the Philippine Commandos. Now, if you've never met her face to face, we think it's about time you did. So here she is, the lady you knew as Mrs. Peters, Miss Julia de la Calzada. And here she is.
I don't think I've ever had the pleasure of meeting you.
You certainly knew about her then, though, didn't you?
Yes.
Now, Miss De La Calzada, just what tasks did Roy here and the other guerrillas under your command perform during the Japanese occupation?
We did espionage work, and we forwarded information to Allied intelligence in Australia. We got inside the prison camp and helped over 1,000 prisoners escape. And we supply food and medicine to civilians, and we carried messages
That's
back
right.
and forth for to civilians to help their families captured. And Roy Keenser,
did more his share, and I'm glad that I have the chance to thank you here. And
well,
through you, to all other brave Americans who help us.
Well, what I did, I thank you very well.
We thank you, Miss Calzada. We thank you, Miss Julia de la Calzada, for your important part in Roy Keezer's life. Thank you. March 18th, 1943. Your heroic usefulness to the American and Philippine cause is interrupted. You're captured by the Japanese. To what prison camp were you taken, Roy?
Fort San Diego.
From where you were later transferred to Santo Tomas.
That's right.
I knew Roy in the dungeons of Fort San Diego and had contact with him at Santo Tomas. We used to pass medicine and messages back and forth to the prison underground.
Now, whose voice is that, Roy? Do you know? Maybe seeing this fellow prisoner of yours will recall him to you. He now lives in Woodland Hills, California. His name is Don Rutter. And here is Don.
I'm glad to see you again. Well, Roy, you probably won't recognize me because the last time I saw you, I weighed about 80 pounds and had a big, flashy red beard.
Yes, I recognize you.
Santo Tomas had been a university, hadn't it, Don, before the Japanese turned it into a prison camp?
Yes, it had, Ralph, and the tower in the campus had a large store of raw chemicals to be made into medicine. The Japanese sealed this tower off, but some of us bypassed the seal and stole all the chemicals. Other Americans made them into medicine. And through the underground, we got them to our own sick prisoners and many prisoners that were in other prison camps throughout the Philippines.
Yes, and Roy Keezer here was a part of that underground chain?
Yes, he was, sir.
Well, thanks to you, Don Rutter, and many others like you, uncounted numbers of American lives were saved. Join Roy's past there, please. Don Rutter. As we come to February 4th, 1945. Liberation for you as General MacArthur fulfills his promise to return to the Philippines. Free at last, restored to your family, you face a brighter future, Roy. By January of 1946, you have a good job, head of the Navy Yard Police at Olongapo, Zambales. A job that again enables you to provide for your wife and your children. But your ordeal is not yet over. June 1946. In a jeep, you're transporting a prisoner. On a lonely road, you're waylaid by a band of hucks. Who or what are hucks, Roy?
Well, it's right now, I think they're just about the same as the Red. They're communists.
Against all law and order, you might say.
Dissatisfied group. It's more or less, again, all law and order at the present time. It's the way I understand it and see it.
And Americans in particular.
Yes, they seem to be now, again, Americans.
Will you tell us what happened that night in the jeep, Roy?
Well, I was driving along. I had, I forget just how far it is from Manila to Longapu, but it's better than 100 kilometers, I think. And I was trying to get back by daylight. I was driving along the highway in my jeep. And I noticed the weapons car in a jeep pass me. And there was, I'd judge, about 16 to 20 men in the two vehicles. And when they got alongside of me, they slowed down and looked me over. Well, I thought something was wrong at the time, but I kept going. And I got up the road about, a mile, I guess, or something like that, and they had the road blocked. Well, I had 45 and three clips of ammunition, and they had Tommy guns, nothing much I could do.
Did they run over you in the jeep?
They beat me up first, and then they run over me. And that's the last I remember till, well, I was picked up by a bunch of GIs from Clark Field Air Base. They'd been in Manila.
They'd left you there for dead, the Hucks. The GIs come along, they rush you to the hospital at Fort McKinley. You're unconscious for 11 days, and almost miraculously, the Army doctors return you to health and to your family.
Right.
And out of this experience, a determination takes hold in your heart and mind. Your children, American citizens, shall have the opportunities that America has to offer. You talk it over with your wife and reach a decision. So on March 29th, 1952, you leave the Philippines and your family. Now increased by the addition of three sons, Eugene, born in 1946, Ralph, born in 1948, and Woodrow, born in 1949. Alone, back here in your homeland, your thoughts and your heart are with your children still in the Philippines, especially since the Hucks tried to abduct them and set fire to their home. How much money have you saved toward their passage, Roy, would you say?
Well, I have about $600 now.
You've been sending them $40 a week for their support.
Yes, sometimes more.
The need is urgent. Their very safety is at stake, and more especially since Aida, your wife, their mother, died last May. We agree with you that as Americans, they are entitled to all the opportunities that only America offers. So hang on now, Roy. Hazel Bishop has flown your six children from the Philippines to America, and they're here to stay. You haven't seen them in a year and a half. And here they are. There we go.
Hello.
Well, there they are, Roy, as handsome a family as you'd ever want to see, safe with a father who we know will see to it that his children will have the chance that fate denied him in his childhood. Irene, you sit over here, darling. Come on. What a beautiful girl. This is the oldest girl, Irene. She's got little Ralph here. Here's Eugene, and here's Woodrow. Here's Woodrow. There's Ralph. I'm all mixed up. Here's Gertrude, the whole bunch. Come on. This is your life. Roy Keezer, your family, your friends are around you and with you. Mother, why don't you sit over here that's the stuff. Look upon your past only as an inspiration for the future. Yeah, here we go. Come on up with Daddy here, pal. There we go, right up here. You hold him here. There we go. Look upon your past only as an inspiration, Roy, for the future, and we'll take a look with you in that direction in just a moment.
You know, the other day I met a woman who said she didn't wear Hazel Bishop lipstick, and I asked her why, and she said, well, I got over that schoolgirl dating a long time ago. Now, listen, ladies, you don't have to be a schoolgirl going out on dates to wear Hazel Bishop lipstick. Hazel Bishop lipstick is for women of all ages who are interested in a long-lasting lipstick. Of course, that's the most important thing of all, you know. I'd like to have you watch Miss Doris Carr as she shows you how to properly blot your Hazel Bishop lipstick, just like that, so it won't smear off. I realize, of course, that some of you ladies don't like to blot your lipstick. It's entirely up to you, but if you would like to go to that extra little bit of trouble, you'll find Hazel Bishop lipstick stays on and positively will not smear off. Yes, and you'll find that unlike other brands, Hazel Bishop stays on, bright and pretty all day and all evening. And speaking of bright and pretty, you ought to see Hazel Bishop's coral and real, real red. Coral is shade that goes wonderfully with the new browns that are being worn this season, and real, real red is the only really true red. It's the shade that all of the women are wearing with almost everything this year.
Well, thank you very much, Bob, and ladies, just let me say this to you, just this much. Regardless of your age, what you do, or what shade you like, Hazel Bishop is America's largest selling lipstick because it's America's longest lasting lipstick. Roy, I know this is a happy moment for you. We're not going to ask you to talk or anything like that. We really had TWA constellations flying all over the world, didn't we, gang? Our guests fly luxurious 300-mile-an-hour TWA Transworld Airlines constellations, the airline that flies three-quarters of the way around the world. Experienced TWA pilots and hostesses make sure that our guests fly with the finest, TWA. Did you enjoy the airplane ride, Eugene? Huh? Did you have fun on the airplane ride? Which is Woodrow? Who's Woodrow?
This is Woodrow.
This is Woodrow. This is Ralph. Okay. Right after the show, Hazel Bishop has arranged a big family dinner just for you folks over at the Hollywood Roosevelt Hotel. All your families had accommodations over there and friends. You'll receive a 16-millimeter film of this program and a Bell & Howell 16-millimeter sound projector so that You can enjoy this over and over again. Now, as to the future, Roy, let's look at it together. The money that you have saved, dollar by dollar, toward this goal, which we have hastened for you, that money, if you wish, can now be used as a down payment on that modest house or whatever you want, which you hope to purchase when and if you'd be able to send for your children. But in the meantime, you and your children will need a place to live in on a temporary basis. Now, we have scouted around for a suitable rental for you and have a list of houses for you to choose from. Now, there's one offered by the Volunteers of America. Another is right on the beach. You can take your choice, Roy. Hazel Bishop will pay the rent for you for 3 months to get you started, see? And so that you will have time to get acquainted with your children and get settled, the wonderful fellow who is president of the company you work for, Mr. M.R. Pepar, Jr. of the Aluminum Taper Milling Company, is giving you a week's vacation with pay, sir. How about that, Roy? He's a great guy, isn't he? Now, all your brothers and sister-in-laws and your mother, Roy, are eager to help you get started in this new home. But the children will need someone to look after them while you're at work, for a while at least. Since the death of your wife, they've been cared for, as you know, by a wonderful lady, a teacher. Well, Roy, we've brought her here from the Philippines with your children, and even though she has a little family of her own back there, she says she'll be happy to stay here for a while to sort of give you a hand to get started. Now, here she is, Mrs. Loreto D'Honor. Mrs. D'Honor.
How much I appreciate what you did.
I told Mrs. Kessler that I'll deliver your children to you in person. By the way, this is the way God
answers prayers, isn't that right?
That's true.
Yes, bless your heart, Mrs. D'Honor. That's all right, my dear. This has been quite a struggle for this lovely lady.
Yes, she's had this hard a time.
She certainly has. Now, you can just take her backstage there, if you would. I think this lady deserves from all our hearts the tribute that we all should give her. She's come all the way to make sure that these children have been taken care of. We know that these youngsters will be in good hands, Mrs. D'Honor. And finally, Roy, we realize that now, more than ever, you need transportation. Hazel Bishop has for you a gift that is really wonderful. It's yours with the compliments and best wishes of two wonderful fellas from Chicago. From Cold Finder, Chicago's busiest mercury dealer, 2700 North Cicero Avenue in Chicago, comes your gift of a brand new 1953 Mercury to take the kiddies all around. We want to thank our very good friends, Mr. Cole and Mr. Finder, for their handsome gift. Two XGIs, Cole and Finder, have hearts as big as the business they have built since teaming up after serving in World War II. Now, Roy Keyser, to add to your pleasure for life, here are the keys to your beautiful new Cole Finder Mercury. Children, how do you like... How do you like your first day in America?
I like it very much.
You do, darling? Bill, all of you. May this be just the start of many happy and productive years for you and your wonderful family, Roy. Hazel Bishop says good luck, Roy Keyser. May God bless you, sir.
God bless you all.
Thank you. Good night,
sir. One place that could do anything like this, and that's America.
That's America. You bet you, sir. It is. Good night to you, ladies and gentlemen. Until next week at the same time, another big surprise on This Is Your Life. Good night.
This Is Your Life is directed by Axel Gruenberg, produced by Alfred Paschal, and Axel Gruenberg for Ralph Edwards. Don't miss the Ralph Edwards story in motion picture and television magazine, now on sale. This Is Your Life, television's most talked about program, is brought to you each week at this same time by Hazel Bishop Long-Lasting Lipstick and by Hazel Bishop Long-Lasting Complexion Glow. This is Bob Warren inviting you to watch Hazel Bishop's other great TV program, The New Peter Potter Show. See your local paper for time and channel, and be sure to see This Is Your Life every week at this same time.